these things is not like the others. One of these things doesn't belong. Can you tell which thing is not like the other by the time I finish this song?
Can't you tell which one was different, and did you do that before we finished the song? When we're kids, that's one of the skills you learn. How do you differentiate between things? How do you sort them out? And that's a great skill to have. The challenge comes when we're adults. When we're adults, we do that automatically. We look at somebody and we see how they're different instead of how we're the same. We focus on what divides us instead of what brings us together. And part of being a follower of Jesus is recognizing what makes us the same. So, little test this morning. 3/4 and a nickel. Tell the people beside you what you see that's the same or different. Go ahead and take a moment to do that. How many saw more things different than the same? How many saw more things same than different? Because you know where the message is going. Very good. How about 2 cats and a dog? Tell the people beside you what's the same, what's different between 2 cats and a dog. Okay, how many are dog people? How many are cat people? How many are no pet people? Well, there's dogs and there's cats, but aren't they both pets? Aren't they both all three animals? We focus on differences, and we often miss what's the same. We're in the second week in a series called Make Your Mark. I invite you to pull out the blue insert in your order of service and take notes on this morning's message, as well as use this week's Grow, Pray, Study Guide. What's amazing about this series is we're looking at 7 values that God wants to put in our lives as his followers to make a dent in the universe, to lead people to know the joy of the resurrection of Jesus, of that power, not just of long ago, but it worked today. And so last week, we looked at Acts chapter 10, and we looked at this story where Peter describes to a man named Cornelius these acts of Jesus that were goodness, intentional acts of goodness, that you are God's app in this world to bring his love in action, not by accident, but on purpose, with intentionality. And this morning, we look at a second value. And that's this idea that God invites us to build on common ground. Our world does a great job of describing what divides us, but Jesus draws us together, and he seeks to build a life on common ground and to grow a relationship from what we have in common and to watch that to continue to expand and grow. Now, please understand, I am not trying to say that we don't deal with differences. I know we need to deal with them, but often the best way to do so is to start with common ground, where we begin. The church living in community in Acts chapter 2 and 4 does something that no other church has done since then. They sold all their possessions and lived in community, and we would call it a commune. American Christians freak out over that part of the story. We go, they're a bunch of communists? We are not communists, by the way. But they were. They were generous people, though. Now, no church since then has kind of followed that blueprint for growth. None of the churches Paul planted followed that blueprint for growth. I am not suggesting, even though we're building on common ground, that we all live in a commune together. My snoring would keep you awake at night. You wouldn't want that. But I am suggesting this. Instead of focusing on the part of the verse we fear a little bit, let's focus on the first half of the verse, where God calls us to follow him with faith. And so look at Acts chapter 4, verse 32 in your message outline, the first part of that verse. All the believers were one in heart and mind. Would you join me in reading that together? All the believers were one in heart and mind. And in a very short time, the church in Jerusalem exploded with growth. Some people would say they turned the world upside down. I kind of think it went the other way. I think they turned the world right side up. And the church, which started with 3,000 on Pentecost Sunday, in a couple of decades got up to about 100,000 people. Why? People had seen a risen Savior. They had experienced his love. They found common ground to build on. And they continued to expand that common ground, inch by inch, mile by mile, person by person, to know who Jesus is. An early church father is called Tertullian. And Tertullian quotes a pagan who says this. He said, look how the church, how they love each other. It was a powerful witness to the people of that day, because this guy who wasn't even a Christian understood that in his day, people looked out for themselves. They didn't look out for other people. They took care of themselves first. Except he looks at the church and he sees this common factor, how they love each other. And so as we get ready to kind of drill down on this idea of being of one heart and one mind, of building on common ground, let's first go to our great God in prayer. Holy Spirit, thank you for building our faith on the common ground of God's word and his great love for us. As we dig into your word today and seek to make your mark on this world, lead us to build from where we are the same and not to be consumed by how we are different. As all the believers were one in heart and mind, we praise you for your desire to make all our hearts and minds as one in Jesus' great love. In his name I pray. Amen. So to build from a common ground focus, the Holy Spirit's at work to kind of tweak how we see life, to kind of realign our vision of life, to see what's the same instead of different, to see how God can stretch us to focus on that common ground. So we're going to look at three ways to do that. The first way is this. You look for more for what's the same instead of what's different. It's not the way we're wired in our day. We're wired to see differences, and that causes division. And God invites us first to see common ground, and that builds unity. Think of three quarters and a nickel. Legal tender. You can use them in a parking meter in La Mesa. Or you can use them in a candy machine, my preferred option for using quarters and nickels, and lots of them. Last night somebody pointed out to me, all of them say, "In God we trust." And I'm like the theologian. You would have thought I would have got that one. They're all U.S. money. And yet our default mode is to divide. It's us versus them. It's red state versus blue state. It's liberal versus conservative. Man versus woman. And yet God seeks to invite us to start on common ground. We have a tendency to sort people. And when we begin to sort people, we begin those lines of division. And the challenge for you and for me is that as we reach out and we try to sort who this person is and sort that person, that by sorting people, we think there are differences that divide us instead of what pulls us together. Look at what it says here in Acts chapter 4, verse 32. This time the whole verse. All the believers were one in heart and mind. No one claimed that any of his possessions was his own, but they shared everything they had. You can see how the New Testament works, how the early church started to reach out to people, how it expanded just from a little Jewish community to reach the whole world. Last week we looked at the story of Cornelius. That's in Acts chapters 9 and 10. And Cornelius is a Gentile Roman soldier. He's not Jewish. Peter is Jewish. And God brings them together. And Peter begins to understand that God doesn't show favoritism. He loves all people. And Peter builds from the common ground of the intentional acts of goodness that Jesus did. Peter's not the only one that operates that way. A Paul, a follower of Jesus, who persecuted the church and then becomes a champion for the church. He goes to Greece at some point. He gets to this place called Mars Hill. He's looking all over, this nice Jewish man, and he sees all these idols and all these altars. And he finds one altar. They ran out of gods, basically. They said, just in case we missed one, we're going to put an altar up for the unknown God. Paul, who believes that idols are worthless, Paul, who believes that there's only one God, he doesn't lead with that statement, though. He builds from common ground. He says, I can see that you're very religious. Under his breath, he might have thought, because you got like an altar everywhere. In fact, you got so many, you don't even know one of the gods. And he points out that altar to the unknown God. He says, what you've identified as an unknown God, let me share with you who he is. He doesn't quote from the Bible. He quotes from their philosophers. And then he tells the story of Jesus, who came not just for one group of people, but came for all people. He invites us to grow on this idea of common ground, that there are things that you and I have in common as followers of God. Peter's way to do that, Paul's way to do that, and then John's way to do that. Look what it says here in 1 John chapter 3, verses 4 and 5. Everyone who sins breaks the law. In fact, sin is lawlessness. But you know that he appeared so that he might take away our sins. And in him is no sin. We all have this in common. We all are sinners in need of a Savior. That's something that we all share. We all have fallen short. We've missed the mark. We've done what is wrong. We failed to do what is right. And when Jesus came, he came to die for all people. And when Jesus offers the gift of salvation, of a new life and a living hope, it's offered to all people. We all have that in common. And so as you begin to reach out to people, to connect, to let them know who Jesus is, or simply to establish a stronger relationship, you build off that common ground. It was described to me once as the 101% principle. You find the 1% you agree on, and you pour 100% into that. I didn't know the name of the principle, but I learned how to apply it between my freshman and sophomore year of college. The guy that I agreed to room with my sophomore year of college, we had a 1% agreement. We both agreed we didn't want any of those new freshmen rooming with us. We didn't want to break in those newbies. And so we agreed to room together. That's all we agreed on. When we both showed up in the fall, that was our one agreement. Then we found a second agreement. This was the 1970s. Show me some grace here. We both liked Olivia Newton-John. I had an 8-track tape. We listened to Olivia. I liked rock. He liked country. I introduced him to good music, and he introduced me to Willie Nelson and the Boys. He wore white T-shirts all the time. I introduced him to color. I didn't have a white T-shirt. All I had were colored shirts. And we took the 1% we agreed on, and it became 2% and 5%. And we became good friends during that year. God invites you to build your relationships by identifying not the 99% where you disagree that has to be dealt with, but the best way to deal with that is to start with the 1% you do agree and pour 100% into that. Is there a tension in one of your relationships? Find the 1% you agree on. Pour 100% into that. Is there somebody you want to share Jesus with? Find the 1% you agree on and pour 100% into that. We're going to build from common ground. If the Holy Spirit's going to lead us to do that, we focus more on where we're the same than where we're different. Here's a second principle. You focus more on the majors than you do on the minors. It's sad that in the history of the church, there are just multiple denominations and expressions of the Christian faith. Some of that is because we all have different styles, but some of it is we argue about some crazy stuff, even in churches. And yet to be a follower of Jesus is to have this common ground, that He died for us, that new life is found in a relationship with Him. Look how they put it here in Acts chapter 4, verse 33. With great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and much grace was upon them all. With their works and their words, their emphasis was to connect people to Jesus. Didn't matter their background, didn't matter where they came from. They took this common message that we all are sinners in need of a Savior, and they told the story of how Jesus died on the cross for our sins. For everybody, and then rose again on the third day. It was the incredible story of what it means to be a follower of Jesus and the great work that He's done for us. And so they built on that foundation because that was the foundation Jesus had laid out. Listen to these verses from the gospel reading earlier from Luke 24. Then He, that's Jesus, opened their minds so they could understand the Scriptures. He told them, this is what is written. The Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance and forgiveness of sins will be preached in His name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. You build on common ground when you build from God's Word, when you build on the foundation of God's Word. We as a congregation have five core values. One of them is unity. We're looking at that this morning. But the first one is the foundation of God's Word. We hear this incredible story of a God who gives us life and purpose and meaning. How we try to take the gift away from Him and make it just our way instead of His way. And how He reached out in love for us and sent a Savior. And we believe that message is so good. It's not just for me. It's not just for you. It's for all people. And so for us, that's kind of the major thing. How do we connect people to Jesus? What's the common ground that we can build on? We don't deny differences. We just seek to address them first from the common ground that we have, the common faith that is ours, that we all come before this cross and experience the love of Jesus, experience what He desires to give us. And so we focus more on what we're the same than difference. We focus more on majors than minors. And here's a third one. You focus more on what you're for than what you're against. In our society, that this has become how we divide it. You pick the news channel. The news is typically what the other guys are doing. You could watch the same story. I could give you two different news channels, CNN and Fox or CNBC and Fox. It could be the exact same news story. And if you were there, I would be curious to watch how both of them report. And both of their style is to point out what's wrong with the other guy. Politics is driven by fear and hatred. Why? Hate sells. It divides people. One person put it this way. They said, nothing brings two people together faster than the hatred of a third person. I know this to be true. I went to Sharon's 10-year high school reunion, and there is one guy that I hung out with more than other people because I didn't know anybody there. Sharon and this other girl had dated the same guy, and we both hated that guy. We became good friends that night. That's not the way it was designed to go, by the way. Hatred bonds together quickly. But it doesn't build. It destroys. It divides. It tears down. God's way to you and to me is not by hatred, but by love. By love, Jesus came into this world and he died for us. It's easy to focus what you're against, but here are two questions you need to wrestle with this week. What are you for? And who are you for? It's easy to say what I'm against, but if you want to build a relationship that lasts with God and with other people, and even with yourself, the strength comes in identifying what you are for and who you are for, and letting God kind of drive, guide, empower the answer to those two questions. Look what happens here in Acts chapter 4, how they define their answer. Verses 34 and 35. There were no needy persons among them, for from time to time those who owned lands or houses sold them and brought the money from the sales and put it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to anyone as he had need. The early church loved the message of Jesus so much, they said, we've got to share this with other people. They didn't earn it to earn God's love, but because they had experienced God's love, they were wired to express it in terms of meeting needs in tangible ways that showed God's love in action that the Holy Spirit would use to lead people to know the story of Jesus. They identified what some person described as islands of opportunity. And so if they had a resource, they would share it. Because there was an island of opportunity, and they wanted to reach out and connect. And sometimes, yes, it's money, but sometimes it's not money. Sometimes it seems like a very simple action that has a powerful impact. Years ago, two teenage boys went to a tent revival service. And when they walked in, it was full, and they kind of turned around. They were going to leave. And this usher saw that. And the usher said, oh, hey, don't leave out. I'll find you some seats. And so he kind of walked up, and he found seats, and he sat down with them. And instead of leaving, those boys stayed. And God worked through that service, and both those boys at the end were in a relationship with Jesus. An usher took the time, saw an island of opportunity, almost saw a missed opportunity, and ushered them to a couple of seats so they could hear about Jesus. But both boys come to faith. Now, I know one of the two boys. I don't know the second boy. Well, the other boy, though, you may have known him too. His name was Billy Graham. Billy Graham came to faith in Jesus in that service because an usher said, I'm not letting that boy out of here. That this is an island of opportunity. I want him to hear this message and see what God will do. God did a pretty incredible work. You never know what the smallest act of love and kindness will do to transform a life. And that's okay because God does. But God puts across our lives each day these islands of opportunity. And what are you going to do with those? Sometimes as you get ready to hit the sack at the end of the day, it's good just to review what were the islands of opportunity that I have? What opportunity did I seize? And what happened when you did? Opportunities come, and did you seize it? And then what happened when you did? And sometimes you'll look back and you go, oh, I'm sorry, Lord, I missed one there. And the best response is to say, well, next time, Lord. I learned my lesson. Next time, I'll do that. Because these islands of opportunity all flow out of this idea from 1 John chapter 3, verse 1. How great is the love the Father has lavished on us that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. No matter where you are in your life, always remember how much God loves you. It's His great plan and purpose for you. It's His desire that you experience and that you bring that together. That's our common ground. Sometimes we get caught up in competition. We think it's us versus them. We think I have to win and the other person has to lose. But God invites us to grow in this love together. And sometimes God has to kind of bop me on the head a little bit to teach me that lesson. I saw this commercial on sportsmanship from values.com. Please watch.
You rolled out the dawn of the day, hard racing as you made your little getaway. It feels like you've been running all your life, but why?
Big picture. Well, life's going to knock you down at some point. We all have that in common. And God invites us to even build on that common ground, that He will pick us up again. In our world, we focus on one of these things is not the same as the other. And God invites us to pour ourselves into that common ground, to seize those islands of opportunity. To say, God, I'm going to build on this common ground. I'm going to take that 1% that we have in common. I'm going to pour 100% into that and see what you can do. We don't always agree point by point on every single matter, but we can all love alike. We can all be of one heart and one mind. Being of one mind doesn't mean that we all have the same opinion, but we all see the same big picture. Let's go to our great God in prayer. Heavenly Father, how great your love is for each of us that we should be called the children of God. Unite our hearts and minds in the big picture you see when you look at the world. For Jesus came for all and Jesus came for each of us. Holy Spirit, open our eyes to see and our lives to leap on the islands of opportunity you put before us. Unite as one in heart and mind. Lead us to make your mark in our community this week. And all God's people said, amen.